Very few people have had the kind of views that you've had in terms of the insight, I should say, between the U.S.-China relationships in its modern iteration, I should say, in the last couple of decades than you have. You've been very well placed to watch this relationship evolve. I know you've recently come back from D.C. How do you characterize where things stand now in terms of the truce and in terms of the outlook for relations between the two sides?
I mean, in wider D.C., Congress and the White House, I think they want some kind of a deal to bring down the boil, but they know it's not going to address the big issues. Congress has been hearing from, there's a very anti-China feeling in Washington, but Congress has been hearing from their business people. And so they're concerned. The White House is still pretty delusional. The White House thinks that that we are bringing the Chinese economy down to its knees and we just got to hang in there. You know, Kudlow and I think Lighthizer knows better, and the president depends on which day on what he's thinking. But I think on one hand, the White House wants a deal. On the other hand, Trump has a calculation that if he keeps a trade war going, it'll be good for him in the election. But then he's also concerned that if the economy blows up, that it could hurt him. So he's stuck between the economy and his rabble-rousing for the election. So it's an interesting situation.
And you also, of course, have good insight into how the Chinese are weighing up their strategy. Is there any shift going on there? Are they going to push to get this signed off in November? And they're going to try and keep tech and all those other issues separate in terms of these negotiations? What is the Chinese mindset at this point?
Well, I think they're looking at Washington and they're seeing this blowback on what Trump did in Syria. They're seeing the impeachment investigation. And I think they're just going to kind of ride it out for a while. You know, they can control the blowback in their economy a lot better than we can. So I think they will make concessions, but they're not going to make any big concessions because they think Trump needs a deal and he's going to need a deal. So let's just kind of mosey along and deal with it. And this $50 billion in agriculture, I mean, there was $9 billion in American farm goods came to China last year. We're going to bring that up to $50 billion. What are they going to do, build soybean mountains around different cities in China?
And what are some of the unintended consequences you're seeing of this growing call for decoupling around technology, around the economy and financial markets?
Well, one thing, you can't decouple if you're not a couple. You know, there is a lot of countries involved in this. And as the U.S. loses market share, it will go to Europeans or the Koreans or the Japanese in a lot of this technology. I'm concerned about the a real unintended consequence of this. Because with the president's entity list, and also with this IEPA law, using emergency powers to say you can't sell to countries or you can't sell to companies, the strongest companies in China from America are the tech companies, the chip companies, the high-tech companies. They have the biggest business and the biggest market share because China can't do it yet. If they're blocked by the White House from being able to do business in this country, that's going to knock out half their earnings for some of them, and their incentives are all to do business. So I'm worried about tech companies decoupling from America over time. By removing some of their operations from the U.S. or their higher tech manufacturing from the U.S. because then if they're exporting from Germany, then it's a German product, it's not an American product under the laws that are being worked. And companies are talking about this now because they have to look out for their business and they have to look out for the long-term disruption of their business. And they think if this president uses these powers, maybe it's going to become a normal thing. We've got to double think it. And it's not that these people are not patriotic Americans, but every business incentive they have is for shareholders and making money. And globalization kind of decoupled them from being very focused on America.
And when it comes to the NBA, you saw this dramatic reaction in China in response to a single tweet. So is this an example of strength and confidence in China or that of a vulnerable and paranoid regime?
Well, you've got, here we have China, the world's second largest economy, a glowing global power in military and politics, acting like a hurt teenager. You know, this is really doesn't make China look good outside of this country. I look at this as the opium wars kind of meets the Great Firewall. Because there's a narrative here that is taught in the schools that China's a victim, today it's about the West keeping China's rising, so all this is happening to try to keep us down, and so people here by and large are not very well informed of what's really going on in the world. at the same time, you don't have a lot of Chinese voices that are out in the world because they are blocked from expressing their opinions around the world by the Great Firewall. So all you get is a hardline view from the government. And it's really unfair because this is a country of very good people, a lot of very open-minded people. That does not translate across borders. And so it's really dividing the world in a really unfortunate way. And the NBA is kind of an example of that.